All right, welcome everybody to our live stream. This is Marie Claire. For those of you who are just joining us now, this is Marie Claire Duquette. I am Schleza's social media coordinator and I facilitate these live streams for Jochen. And we'll be welcoming Jochen in just a couple moments. We're just gonna take some time, a couple minutes just to let people show up and join us. So please be patient with us. So please comment where you're from in the chats, whether you're on YouTube or Facebook, feel free to comment where you're from. And if you have any questions, feel free to leave those in the chat as well. And we will do our best to get to as many of them as we can. For those of you who don't know, we've been doing this on a weekly basis for, I think this is our fifth week in a row. And we are so, so happy to be able to do this and to answer all your questions and help create more of a dialogue in the equestrian industry, because it's so important for us to help horses and riders everywhere and prevent long-term damage. So we're really, really grateful that you guys are joining us and helping us spread this message. If you can please share this post on your page, we'd really appreciate it as well. It really helps us reach even more followers. And yeah, so thank you again. Post where you're from, post your comments, and bear with us for a couple more moments. We're just going to be welcoming Jochen in just a few minutes. All right, for those of you who are just joining us now, thank you for your comments. This is Marie Claire. I'm Schleza's social media coordinator and I'm facilitating these live streams for everybody. So I'd like to just welcome you all to today's live stream and just let you know we will be welcoming Jochen in just a few moments. We've been doing these on a weekly basis and we're so happy to be doing them, but we just, we're waiting for a little bit more people to show up into the live stream. So please comment where you're from and comment any of your questions that you may have, and we'll be happy to answer them as soon as Jochen comes in. Again, we'd like to thank everybody for the incredible response that we've been seeing over encouraging us with these live streams. We're really, really grateful.
Well, 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 hello. Mary Claire, how are you today?
Hi, Jochen, how are you?
Excellent. We had a little difficulty with a technical issue, but that's what's to expect these days, isn't it?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, so like you said already, I'm gonna adjust the camera a little bit here, there you go. You mentioned already, this is the fifth week and I can't believe how fast time goes. And for all the folks out there who have not seen this before, we normally start with a little introduction of why I do what I do and who I am and why we do this. Marie Claire already said a lot to it, but let's go right to the meat of it. Myself, I'm passionate about horses and I jump out of bed every morning and I want to help as many horse and rider to protect from ill-fitting saddles. My goal and my passion is to make sure that every horseback rider knows that. That's why I surrounded myself with professors and veterinarians from all over the world. Here we see Christian Payam from, this is the gentleman in the brown shirt here from Vienna, and in the middle, Wolfgang Meyerhofer. He's a veterinarian chiropractor in Germany. Then we have here on this picture, Professor Weishaupt. He is in Zurich, very, very busy with saddle research. And what I love about these gentlemen, they're not paid by a company, they have their own independent research. And when I learned that we have to actually make a saddle fit to a moving animal, isn't that what we all want, that saddle to fit on the horse? It was a complete different approach, not only to saddle making, also to saddle fitting. And as I numerous times explained, there are so many opinions out there, but yet the anatomy of the horse and the anatomy of the rider is what it is. This is facts and these are science, and that's what I want to do. I want to share with all of you the knowledge I acquired over the last 42 years. So before that, I was, of course, riding, and none of you should make all the mistake I did and just follow blindly somebody's opinion or because he's good in one or the other sport. I really hope with these webinars that all of you listen to the expert. Here's another one. He will be on our live webinar on August 22nd. We have numerous experts. What I love about Dr. Gerd Heuschmann, he speaks for what he believes on. And like my wife always says, you can believe on everything, but you don't believe really on anything. So what you really, really want to do is, if you want to help your horse, listen to the experts. And this gentleman here, who, like all veterinarians, follow their motto, do no harm, said, I can inject the horse, I can cut the nerves, I can freeze the back, but I really became a veterinarian to help horses. And I see many, many horses out there who have very bad posture from ill-fitting saddles or bad riding. So my tours took me literally around the world. And then I came to Sao Paulo in South Africa, Brazil. I met a wonderful veterinarian, Dr. Solange Miguel. She then put Saddle Fit for Life into the universities there, what is taught by Lily Crutchmere. You see her right there holding her degree. And these are all veterinarians who spread the news now. Fitting saddles to fashion? No. Fitting saddles to science and respect the law of nature. And this is what Schlese is all about. Schlese builds saddles and makes saddles with all the information I got way after my, well, certificate as an apprentice. And after 3 years as a journeyman, additional going to master school, I got my master's and I had to produce a saddle in front of other masters. And then the real understanding was only surrounding myself with experts from all over the world, such as this gentleman here in Durban, that's South Africa. And he runs a jockey academy. And then people say, jockeys? They're horses too. The racing industry, the jockeys and the racehorses have something in between what we call a saddle, an exercise saddle and the race saddles. And if we build them to the anatomy of the horse while respecting the law of nature, the horse can do actually way better. And I'm so proud to say that we actually introduced and made a huge difference to the well-being of the racing industry, because I followed what I learned from all these expert veterinarians from all over the world who studied the biomechanics, the physiology, the anatomy of the horse. So when we look through all this, in the end, we created an exercise saddle, which was so well received. Horses do not get pushed away. If it's racing, if it's dressage, hunter, jumper, reining, barrel racing, doesn't matter. The second a human is on the horse's back and you put a saddle in between, we call that saddle with as long as it has a tree. But if you have a saddle in between a human and an animal, that saddle can fit to the anatomy of the horse. So the function, if it's racing or dressage, can be so you don't hurt the horse. Because in the end of the day, if you're the jockey, the owner, the trainer, the pro rider, you all want the same, you want to win. If you say, I'm just a pleasure rider, I just love my horse, I just ride through the woods, I don't race, I don't do dressage, I don't do barrel racing, you still want the horse to be in comfort. And you don't want to have the horse suffering in silence. I'm very proud to say that this book last year in Kentucky won the film, I know I have a brain fart, won the best educational book. And very proud of this to say that this book is also used in many universities. They use this as a research and different saddle fitting school. What I also like, I was a big fan for Sue Dyson, and I find out, and she's a big fan of myself, and she worked with me together in England, and she also wrote an article or an equine journal what talks about the ethogram, which shows how the horse is in pain. So in pain, what does that mean? How does a horse show us in pain? And she done a wonderful, I have a little link here, you can see it down there, and a wonderful explanation. Does the horse really need to be in pain or not? So when I adopt everything I learned, I can ignore it or I can put it in the product. But I follow what my master say. My master sold me as a rider. He said to me, Jochen, riding takes 3 human lives. And it's a duty of every rider to teach what he learns to his students or the fellow riders. And I took that order. He was a cavalry officer, the gentleman who I learned riding in Germany. I took that as a saddler. And I find it is my duty to share this with all saddle makers, with everybody worldwide, that there is actually a way to go back the way it was over 150 years ago when you made saddles for function and not for fashion. Today, there's a lot of opinion, but if you follow the science and the law of nature from these experts, horses don't need to show you these faces. They do not need to be so much in pain. And little did I know what it's been written a long time ago by Udo Berger, who wrote a book, The Rider Forms a Horse. It's done in 1905, he published that book. Think about the title, The Rider Forms the Horse, okay? So horses are in pain because of bad riding. That's what Dr. Gerd Heuschmann, as a veterinarian, who was also a berider, he'd done an apprenticeship as a berider, so he has both titles, right? So he's a professional rider. So he really can explain it from a rider as well as from a science. He can really bring it clearly across. And yet there's still a lot of people who hurt the horse. For me, the animal abusers, and all saddle makers who don't make saddles what fit to the anatomy of the horse and listen to the experts are also animal abusers. Now you can say, well, you know, they don't know what they don't know. That's true. But come on, with all this publication, what's out there, with everything, we can't say, I don't know what I don't know, especially if you, the consumer, you give a saddle fitter, you give a retailer, a company, your horse, the trust, and you hope they do the best for them, only to find out they fit a saddle to their opinion or detriment of the horse. We talked about the 8 myths of saddles. Check this out. There's 8 different styles of saddles can fit. If you believe in 1, 2, 7, then you will ride the horse in pain. If you fit your saddle to number 8, tree lift fit, then you ride your horse to the function. So enough about me, enough about Udo Berger, who says the rider forms a horse. This is about the hour for you. This is for me to be here for you, to share with you the questions you have. So hopefully, we, like Mary Claire says, we keep the dialogue open and we can help you to answer some question, and we go back the way it was when saddles made for function, and we ask everybody, think about this quote from Charles Darwin. You know, think about this. You know, we have to change. Times are changing, especially with the pandemic we're all living in. You know, it's not the strongest that survives, nor is the most intelligent, but the one what adapts to changes, because we do have changes. And one of the most common changes is the fact that medical doctors writing books. This is a webinar I did on the 24th about the difference about male and female riders. That's the change. We cannot deny it as manufacturers. You all cannot deny that the majority of the riders, English or Western, are women now. And if we don't adapt to changes, if you don't want to survive, good. If you say you have more money than God, good. But if you have a heart and you love the horse, don't you want to listen to the people who really want and really know how a horse can be in pain or not in pain? So anyway, enough about me, enough about that. Let's talk about Schleser and what I teach worldwide about this to all saddle and horseback riders from all over the world. This is about you, as I said. It doesn't matter what discipline you ride. In the end, we want to fit tall or small, we fit them all. So Mary Claire, I'm ready for you and your clients and your first question.
Awesome. Thank you so much for that great introduction, Jochen. Again, we're so grateful to have you here and to be able to ask our questions and to have this dialogue with you. It's really, really valuable information and we really appreciate it. So the first question comes from Amy in Canada, and she says, I feel as though I am constantly fighting the saddle and correcting my posture. What does this say about my saddle fit and how should it feel to ride in a well-fitting saddle?
Mary Claire, do you find that is a question that comes often, isn't it? Right? And I think I'm glad that comes often because people may follow us every week, but then some people may just discover us for the first time. And I like to start with this slide. This is one of my dearest pictures here. I love that woman. And that horse was pretty cool too. But doesn't that picture say it all? We want to do good for the horse. So what has that to do with the question? It has something to do, if a medical doctor writes a book about the rider's pain-free back, and there is different shape in the spine of the male and the female, different pelvises, different hip sockets, different angulation in the humerus. This is just bones. Never mind about the soft parts. So if we make saddles, what made by men, for 4,500 years, and since 1978, the majority of women riding, riders are no women, they're riding in the male saddle. No wonder you struggle. This is the picture out of the book, the video, The Pliable Seat of the Spanish Riding School. Since 400 years, this school is in existence. And to this date, they talk about the proper seat. The proper seat is what you see, this line here. That has to be shoulder, hips, and heels, one line, while the sternum of the horse and the sternum of the rider be in line. This woman here sits back, toes out, knees out. So that goes pretty much in the way that question was. I constantly struggle with my position. Like Dr. Warson was saying, there is big differences between the skeleton of the woman and the male. So if you put that skeleton on the horse, two different skeletons, but the saddle in between is made for men, you will always struggle. Okay, so you cannot deform your skeleton. You cannot, look at this. Very clear, I can't see my video. I don't know if you can see this tree. So I don't know if I lost connection, so I pretend we're still there. So we see here a tree with...
Sorry, I was muted. We're still live and I can see the tree. Sorry, I was muted there.
All right, okay. So here you see a reinforced, this is a flex tree. Then there's plastic trees and there's wood trees. So you will not form with your strength the tree. So think about the saddle has a skeleton, the tree, like the horse and you. But if the skeletons don't match, the tree and the pelvis and the riders don't match, you will always, always struggle. Let me show you how the horse will react, okay? I'm gonna show you a little video clip what will show you how this very, very famous rider, she's a trainer, and she takes lessons from Anne Gribbins. Anne Gribbins is a Olympic judge. She flies all over the world. She rode and trained over 25 Grand Prix horses herself. And they both struggled with this incredible good horse. And all we did, put this person in a proper gender appropriate saddle and fitted the saddle to the law of nature. Check out the movement of the horse. Okay, so here, nice horse, but wrong bent at C3 and trots out of the elbow. The rider leans a little back. Okay, tries to avoid the front. Keep in mind, this is a custom saddle, custom made for that horse, but not to the pelvis of the rider. Now we have supple, pliable pelvis. The rider becomes very soft. Now look at the horse. Look at this horse trot through the shoulder. Look how much the haunches come underneath. Now check it out, side by side. Trotting out of the elbow, or come, all the motion out of the shoulder. Look at the position in the rider. Same horse, same rider. The only difference was she actually followed the law of nature by saying, hey, guess what? My pelvis has a birth channel and males don't. So why wouldn't I have a saddle what fits more my anatomy versus the male's pelvis? Okay, so if the front of the pelvis, like you see here, cuts and hits the front, of course the rider leans back. But if you get a saddle where the lady has comfort, pardon me, in the crotch, and you can now do what they teach in 400 years, a pliable seat, wow, you're soft. You become one with the horse, and the horse becomes big on whoosh, whoosh, and he comes through the haunches. Isn't that what we all want? My passion is so to help horse and rider to stop to be crippled by saddles. And I love, love, love when my team comes back and says, you, the people are crying and say, thank you. And that's what we all pay the big bucks for. It costs so much money to keep a horse these days, and it's not getting cheaper. So why would you put a metal reinforced saddle or go with a saddle pad or treeless saddle and fight against the law of nature? Please don't do this to yourself. Don't cripple to yourself. If you don't want to listen to me, that's fine. Listen to the experts. If you want to make lots of years of mistakes and wait to find out what I learned by flying around the world almost every year twice, or join us, follow us, because we're here to give and share and hopefully make a difference so we all protect and love our horses while we always do. I'm sorry, it was a little long, Mary Claire, but I'm really passionate about it. And the horses love me for this.
Thank you for that awesome answer, Jochen. Don't apologize anymore for the length of the answers, because I think we all know, you know, just how much information goes into, you know, having to explain all of this, right? So yes, we know, yes. We expect the length of the answers, and we appreciate it. So the next question comes from Emily, and she's in California, and she says, how can I tell if my saddle is too long for my horse's back?
Okay, so how do I start that? Let me think for a second.
While you're looking for slides, I'll just say really quickly, sorry, I forgot to mention this. My internet connection is really bad. So if I'm cutting in and out, don't worry, we're still live and we'll still, you know, be coming back online shortly. And I'm sure Jochen is still here. So don't just have patience with us, please. And feel free to share this stream if you can on your pages. We really appreciate it. So thank you. Yeah, sorry, Jochen. Go ahead.
Okay, so how do we start with this? All right, how can you tell the saddle is too long? So if I start with this slide, because I'm a big believer, pictures say more than 1,000 words. We all want the horses to move free, shoulder freedom, like you just saw in the video. You want no pressure in the horse's loin area. Here you see horse's muscular structure, and you see those blue little dots, okay? Every single dot here, it's what, if I press that, not more pressure than I squish a grape, if I press that, the horse will react. This one here, the back one, we call it in the industry actual, the bucking reflex points. So how can you tell? If your horse starts to get stronger shoulders, shoulders coming back, and all of a sudden you lose your walk. That horse, especially when you go to the upper level dressage, the horse gets issues in the walk. Your horse all of a sudden becomes lateral. Uh-oh, that gives you a big downside. What's the other measurements or the other sign what will happen? When the horse moves in the back, walk, trot, and then canter, that happens in this area here. It pushes the saddle onto the shoulder. You see this area here, or the tree digs into the shoulder. So the horse will start, the symptoms will be on the horse, stumble, right? He will be heavy and heavy in the horse, in the hand. He's pushing the neck down and he's, oh my God, he's heavy. He's not coming nicely up through the thoracic sling. He's not coming through the pole nice, because that force, that's what I call law of nature. Okay, we're living in the planet where we got gravity and they got momentum, right? We'll push the saddle forward, it's too long. So the horse will be restricted. This is the respiratory health on the horse. This is BL13. The saddle then will hit that spot that's in the Chinese medicine. We all know this, what we call the acupuncture points. And when your saddle hits that spot, that's a lung meridian point, your horse will be pooping out. It will get, oh, he's so lazy. Oh, we need special food because he's not going forward. He sweats a lot because you're hitting the lung meridian point, and what do you think goes up? The heart rate. And when the heart rate gets artificially raised, we have an increase of cortisol level. Cortisol level is how we measure stress. So if you say, but I don't want to wait, I don't want to wait until this horse shows me all the symptoms. I don't want to wait until I have all this damage and this problems. Well, let me see if I find a slide. Okay, so if you look at your horse from the side, this is a horse I saw in Zurich when I met Professor Weishaupt. Beautiful horse, won left, right, center Grand Prix, cleaned up in Switzerland, and then from one day to the next, he says, I won't have it anymore. Huge problems, and one of the biggest is always, you see this area, Mary Claire, here was a little darker. I don't know what the resolution is, if your clients can see it. But yeah. That area back there, in the old day, my cavalry officer, where I learned from, I never knew what he talked about, the dark zone. He says, the saddle never should sit in the dark zone. Now we know, the veterinarian call it the lumbar area, okay? Wherever the ring of light is, wherever this area here is, the dark zone, your saddle needs to stop right here, okay? So if you see this big horse, that horse was 17.3. Mark, look at where the dark zone starts, and this is where the shoulder ends. Look at this small area here, a tiny little space where that saddle can sit. So how can you tell your saddle is too long? If it sits behind the shoulder, everybody knows we want that saddle not to hurt the cartilage and the shoulder. But if the saddle presses just a little bit in the dark zone, it's a little bit okay? No. Just as there is no such a thing as little pregnant, you are pregnant or you're not pregnant. You are in front of this dark zone or you're in the dark zone. There is no such a thing a little bit, okay? So let me see if I find another good spot where you can see what I call the dark zone, all right? So unfortunately, too many slides. And sometimes I don't know the answers ahead of time, but let me see if I show it to you here. No, I don't have a good picture there. The sign, when it's too long, it gets pushed forward. Then you see the horse get an atrophy here. That's 90% when the saddle is too long. So unfortunately, I see that a lot. And yeah, I think I would prefer we go to the next slide, unless I come across here another one. I had such a good slides. I saw that earlier, what I'm looking for. Maybe I come back to that, and I know as soon as I say, let's move on, I will find one. The way it goes, isn't it?
That's okay. I can, while you're looking, I can always talk about, thank everybody for asking their questions and remind them to share this live stream if you can on your Facebook page. We're also streaming live right now to YouTube. So if you have a YouTube channel and would like to help us promote it there, that'd be great as well. Again, we're just trying to reach as many horses and riders as possible and just help as many people as we can with this information while we have Jochen here answering our questions. So it's really valuable info and we're just trying to get it to as many people as we can. So we really appreciate your help sharing all of it and joining us for these events. It's Thursdays at 3. So just mark that in your calendar or every week and we'll be sure to be here answering your questions.
Okay, so shall we go to advantage, Mary Claire? Can you believe it? It just absolutely disappeared. Maybe we can see a little bit here. Here you see a horse from the side. I don't know, Mary Claire, if you can see that little ring of light.
I can see that. Yeah, a little light there, yeah.
Huh? So the saddle should sit behind the shoulder and away from that ring of light. And I know I had it somewhere close to here. Yeah, there it is. Isn't that something? Very clear, you see here the ring of light, okay? Your saddle can never ever, if your saddle is finished riding and you did a little test ride and you did a dust pattern, you can see that this arrow, the second arrow there, one more to the front, is where the ring of light starts, stops. Look how far this saddle here, where it was tried out, is way too long. The other one, what was little bit too long, little pregnant, doesn't exist, right? It's still too long. You cannot have any contact in the back. Okay. Some people do it purposely to get the false elevation. The horse will buckle, will go from away, drops the back, shoulders come back, and then you got that, what they're called in the old days, short trot. You know, so I am not an Olympic judge. I am a small judge. And what I was taught, you kick the people out when they come in short trot. Today, big controversial. I don't want to deviate too much, but I cannot stand the roll cure and the hyperextension and what people do just to win the medal. I'm a saddle fitter. I have to deal with this all the time. And I encourage all of you, always insist when you have a saddle fitter out there, or saddle ergonomist, equine ergonomist, somebody would help you with the saddle fit, make sure they watch you before and after they adjust the saddle, how you ride and how the saddle fits in motion. Okay, so very critical. The very first we always check is the length of the saddle correct? We're looking for the ring of lights and the end of the shoulder. Okay.
Thanks, Jochen. Sorry, I was muted again. thank you for that wonderful answer. So we're going to move on. While you're already on these photos of the horse's back, let's actually tackle this next question about muscle atrophy, and it's coming from Angela in Canada again, as you're already on those images. But before we do, I just want to thank everybody again for joining us and for asking your questions. If you could share this even to horse groups that you're a part of to help us kind of spread the message, that would be really, really appreciated. Thanks again. We're already like halfway through the stream, which is flying by already. So would really appreciate that. And take it away, Jochen.
Okay, so let's talk about atrophy for a quick second. What is atrophy? Atrophy, if a muscle decreases in sizes for two reasons. Number one, let's say I work out and I get a lot of muscles to my upper body and I'm on the regular program. And then when I don't work out anymore, those muscles will atrophy or shrink to the size my body needs for whatever I do with it, okay? So we know all this old saying, what's called muscle disappear four times faster than body fat appears and vice versa, okay? So atrophy is when you train a young horse and you ride him regular and all of a sudden the horse has an injury and you cannot ride him. So what you put in for 4 months training will disappear in 1 month. Okay, and then you start again. Lucky enough, the muscle memory is there and it will come back faster once it was there. But atrophy has two way of understanding. When we talk about saddle fit, I like to refer always to this article, okay, or this research paper. Okay, so this research paper, this was done in March 2014 at the University of Scotland. And they say, if we have more than 4.66 kPa in Europe, they measure pressure by kilopascal. In North America, they use pounds per square inch. So if you push into the muscle hard enough, what will happen then is the blood flow is restricted. The oxygen, the nutrition cannot go through the muscle, and the muscle atrophies. If the saddle pressure, what does it say here, is over 4.6 kPa, that's not a lot. That's why we build saddles with saddle trees and we fit panels with large weight bearing surface to distribute the rider's weight and the saddle's weight and the rider's clothes and the stirrup irons, everything what goes on the horse. So obviously, with bareback pads, treeless riding, or bareback riding, we're not able to get under this, what is it? 4.66 kPa. So if we have a saddle that fits and distributes the pressure properly, then the muscle will not atrophy. Now, unfortunately, we have many, many saddles now, which are built on fashion, and they are going away from this weight distribution. And what we see is horses with massive deformation in the horse's back. Here you see a picture. I got that from Christian Peham's presentation when I did together with him and Christian Meyerhofer a back symposium back in 17. Okay, so he explained how he tested the spine, how much weight it can sustain and how much it moves up but not down. But if the pressure is high enough, what did this research paper say? If the muscle disappears, the horse will get increasingly back damage up to kissing spine, and there goes your mobility. Okay, so if I have a horse what gets pressured hard enough, okay, or ridden wrong with too much pull, wrong bend, hard on the forehand, back hanging through, doesn't matter if you use thermography, if you, whatever you want to do, you will have severe problems of kissing spine. So the horse does need the strength of the back. If the back muscle will disappear, like you see here, you see first the holding line, and then what happens, the horse has no mobility through the back. Okay, so the worst case you can probably see in this little video here. Okay, if you look at how this little horse is cantering, there's no movement in the spine. It's all fused, no movement in the sacroiliac joint. And the horse is counterbalancing by pushing the neck down, big U neck here. So if you don't want that, okay, pay attention to the first sign because the horse doesn't know how to lie. Look at the eyes, the ears, okay? You do not want to press on the spine. And I always like to refer back, hey, how do the non-paid research, you ask yourself, well, the money got to come from somewhere. I always look from somewhere where no companies behind to say, hey, can you research my saddle? I look to companies who, universities who look at what's going on for the benefit of the horse. Okay, so here we see the article from the Zurich, University of Zurich, how this tree, let me blow this up a little bit so you get an understanding what I'm talking about. This here is the tree. These are the rails. They're becoming narrow and narrow and narrow. And when we get increased pressure through the front, what only goes to what? Atrophy. So if I'm looking at the old saddles, so I'm gonna put that in. You look at how much weight bearing the old saddles have than the Western. The worst are the exercise saddle in the racehorse industry. This is why our racing saddle is so successful. Yesterday from Melbourne, again, we got a super video how happy the trainer is. We're still in data testing with it, but pay attention, come soon, the new exercise saddle. And look at this new modern tree in the English saddles, how narrow they get. So if the rails of the tree becomes narrow and narrow, and the weight bearing surface through the horse becomes higher and higher, and then on top you press all this muscle, this is the vertebrae of the horse here, the nerves on the spine, you press all this away, of course the horse will lose the mobility, the stability, and the horse will be in pain and goes hollow. All right, so atrophy again, if you don't use it, you lose it. You heard that saying before, right? So if the muscle gets built, but then it gets not used, the muscle goes to the size, or if the pressure is so high that there is such an intense pressure, either you measure it with a computer or you wait after the fact when the horse is dissected and you can see that tree just literally damaged the horses completely. Here you see the damage it caused through the cartilage. You see it through thermography. We see it through other universities who talk about dry spots, shearing skin, and again, super atrophy. No, today we got tools, what measures? What does it measure? Have a look. Elevation, trot symmetry, cadence, left-right analysis. A mobile app, a girth, what comes from Europe, what can measure all that? So it's not more opinion, we call that science. And if I just change the right girth, fit the saddle to the function and to the anatomy of the horse. What if what if, just hypothetically, we combine the old way, the wide weight-bearing surface, to decrease the pounds per square inch, like increase the weight-bearing surface, but less pressure, okay? What if we combine these two? So what we did, Edge Laser, we won the Product of the Year award in the Equitana. It's a massive, massive trade show that's all over the world. In New Zealand last November, and we won the Product of the Year award when we introduced our new Binade line, where you have a super narrow twist for the rider, because most ladies today are the riders, and a super wide twist, you see the drawing here, for the horse. So that's what we did. We created a product to decrease the insane amount of atrophy and the insane amount of deformation, what we see on horses today. And we don't need to see this anymore. We don't need to see the horse in pain. We can give the horse what they need, comfort, but we need to respect and listen to the people who dedicated their life to protect horses. And those are the veterinarians, the professors, who give us all this information. I clung on them. I listened to them. I asked the question. I follow my father's saying, the person knows the how will always follow the person knows the why. Always ask your fitter, why you do this? How does it distribute the pressure, right? So don't follow in this trap where you end up jumping like these two people. Many, many horses kick the saddle and the rider to the left. The little pot, it starts with the leg sticking out on the left and the extreme you see here, okay? So this nobody likes to see. But what does a horse has? If you don't listen to the eyes, you don't look at the eyes and the ears, you don't pay attention with the little signs like this, of course the horse tries to avoid the pain somehow. I don't think that these two riders enjoy the horse's performance running away, but I guarantee you they will enjoy it much more if the customer would understand, look at that. The horse's skin is 5 millimeter, but the human skin is 8 millimeter. If you look at the tissue alone, then you look at your fingertips. You know, if you put elastic band around the fingertips, you would not leave that elastic band on there. So if the pressure is too high in these little tiny blood vessels, the capillaries, right? So if you press those, you restrict the blood flow to the muscle what it needs. It's again a long answer, you know, but the horse needs the spine, the spinal muscles, and the horse wants to help and wants to be in harmony. And most people want it too. And that's why I do what I do. I've seen so many people when we show what happened to the horses and when we release the pain. You know, I always refer back to this one picture. And this is the picture I love because it says it all, right? Michelle is still working for us. She's our marketing manager. And doesn't she says it all? All she lives and dreams is for her horse. And most of us who are really, really horse owners, who love horses, they listen to the experts and they're asking the question why, not how.
100%. And that's why I think it's so important that we're hosting these events to help explain the why and explain you know, the questions to all, the answers to all of your questions, and really give you that background, that education background, so that you can make the right decision and protect you and your horse from, you know, damage that you don't need to go through. So thank you, Jochen, for that really fantastic answer again.
You're welcome.
I just want to encourage everybody for joining us, or thank you everybody for joining us, and encourage you to share it if you can. We really appreciate it. Genuinely, we really do. We're really just trying to reach as many people and help as many horses and riders as we can with these live streams, and we're doing them every week. So feel free to join us next week as well. So approaching 15 minutes left of this this lecture or this Q&A. So we have a couple more questions here to answer, but please feel free to leave yours in the comments, and we will hopefully get to them next time. And thank you again for engaging with us. So here is a question from Sarah, and she's from New York. And she says, if I'm a female rider and not, if I'm a female rider and not in pain in a generic non-female saddle, does that mean that I'm not using my seat correctly?
Okay, so There is very good videos in our previous seminars we did, you know, and explains very much how the saddles are different from male to female saddles. And I give a good example in fitting shoes. I can put a shoe in, and my foot in the shoe, and I can kind of squish it in, kind of know it's not 100%, but I'm not in pain. And my foot, my body, my muscle will compensate for it. So if you are a female who has a birth channel, but I'm very petite, I'm very tiny woman, you still have a birth channel, where a male never, no matter how big he is, how strong he is, he never has a birth channel. So what's a birth channel? Birth channel is that the seat bones, you're looking at a pelvis. Can you see the pelvis? If I tilt this way, where my fingers are here, okay, that's where my mouse is right there. That's the hip socket. And then you see the seat bones here. Okay, so you're looking at the slide right here. So a female has a much wider seat bones than a male. Okay? The male has no birth channel, narrow seat bones. See that red line? That red line is the pelvis axis. Every lady has the the balance axis more forward, part of the birth channel. When I sit in the saddle, I sit on my seat bones. If I put my hand under the center of the hip socket, it's absolutely level. And I can easily balance this male pelvis. Look at the top, it's level, okay? So if I look at the female pelvis, okay? Female pelvis have a way more tilt, have more curve, shorter tailbone. This is the pubic branches, pubic symphysis, and the hip socket more forward. If I have that balance point, like I showed you in this picture right here, I'm gonna put my hand here. You're not sitting on the seat bones. Your seat bones are over the edge. If this is level, every female will fall back, okay? If I go flat here and hold my hand kind of level, okay? It won't work because it hits first on the pubic symphysis. I can't make that work and keep that level. So if I'm riding in a saddle, I know it's a male saddle, but I'm not in pain, okay? My recommendation, videotape yourself, slow motion, sitting trot, couple long sides. You want to see if this is shoulder, hips, and heels. You want to see if that aligns. If you are very flexible, you will adapt to it and pull your leg back, and that disc will go slowly further back because you're going to compensate in your lower back and trying to do what a male can do. He can sit deeper in the saddle because his lower back is not as curved as the lady. We have a longer tailbone than the ladies. Again, birth channels. And we're sitting closer. Here's the male, shoulder, hips, and heels. The butt close to the horse's back, tailbone close to the back. The lady, shoulder, hips, and heels. And here we have different curvatures. Ladies more curvature, gluteus maximus sits higher, and the tailbone is shorter. So you see clearly there's a space here. She will fall back if she rides bareback. So if you say, but I'm riding in the male saddle and I don't have pain, you are going to compensate. Like this rider here is compensating by staying somewhat in the middle of the horse's back. That doesn't hurt, but eventually your back will deform and you will get eventually pain because your disc goes over, okay? Because you are not meant to bend your longest bone, that's your femur, okay? You cannot bend it halfway through. So that's the area where we call the twist of the saddle. On males, here you see there's more space between the upper inner thigh, sort of just below the crotch. On ladies, there's much smaller. Yeah, but I'm a skinny lady and I have much more space. You still have hips and your femur goes cone-shaped to the inside. Male saddles are wider through this area here. And if you ignore it, not only will your toe goes out and your knee goes out, you can force your leg back, your joints and hips will pay the price later on. It's just a matter of time. Now, why can I be so sure about this? Very easy. Because I'm listening to the experts. I listen to medical doctors who know exactly when you bend down, just like you do a sit-up, okay, or you do squats, okay? You can bend with your knee over your toe, or you can bend your knee outside of your toe or inside. Your meniscus, your knee, your hips will not sustain that. So when you ride and do the rising trot and your knees are out, your toes are out, you're constantly torquing your joint. It doesn't hurt you yet. It will hurt you because your body cannot sustain it. Again, this is what I read. This is what I heard. So why would I not right away make a saddle for the females? I see the impact of the seat bones much wider, pubic symphysis right there, and the male completely different. So for me, every lady who buys different jeans, different underwear, different bicycle seats, why would she not ride for her anatomy in a female saddle? He said, but I don't have pain. You will get it later.
Awesome. Thanks, Jochen, for another great answer. We just got a question on Facebook for the next one, but really quickly, just want to say thank you again, everybody. We're quickly approaching the end of this live stream, but again, just want to remind everybody that we do this every week. So every Thursday at 3 p.m., you can join us on Facebook or YouTube. Typically YouTube is like a larger screen. If you're on your mobile or if you're on your desktop, it's a better experience on YouTube, but feel free to join us on whatever platform you're on.
Oh, I lost Mary Claire.
Sorry, we'll be live Thursdays at 3. My connection is a little bit poor, so sorry about that. So the next question we have here, we got on Facebook today, and it says, what age do you suggest for the first fitting? My mare is coming up to 3, only groundwork, not riding for about a year. I know she has maturing to do.
Okay, so that question is, I like to always challenge people by thinking about riding as something super unnatural. Okay, so first of all, we can, I think, all agree that horses love to live in the wild and horses love to run around free. And they move in the wild, they move 20 miles a day, looking for food. And there's no rider's back on it. So from the expert we know, a horse's skeleton is pretty much set at 1.5 years old. At 6.5, the growth capsule on the withers closes. Yet a horse that has never been ridden until he was 7 or 8 will change drastically, drastically. So what I'm saying is, while there's this huge controversy in the racing industry, at what age should the horse actually be start being ridden, let's look at this first here. I put that slide up because I wanted you really to think about for a second. What changes the horse's three-dimensional back? What changes this? Is the way how heavy or light or good or bad the rider rides? What type of trainer do you have? Do you believe in the leg mover or the back mover? Do you believe the horses to be round or hollow? What type of nutrition do you give? What's your veterinarian care? Are you just putting band-aids on, or do you have a really good veterinarian who understands the why? Right? So what type of tack? Do you fit the saddle to function or to fashion? All of these, farrier, body workers, all that will help the horse to be healthy in an unnatural environment. A natural environment is captured. The horse has no chance to walk now 20 miles a day. Okay, so that's the first step. I always have to say that first, Because if I don't bring that across, people don't understand why there is so much changes. So at what stage do I start saddling my horse? The minute, or fitting a saddle, the minute you put that saddle on the horse. Why? Because it will change. And I always say, why would you have a saddle on a horse when he's young, he doesn't know what's going on, and it's hurting him? Because you're thinking of, well, I'm gonna get it fit when he's finished and he's grown out. Horses never finish changing the three-dimensional shape of the horse's back. That is an ongoing story. That's why in the old days, the cavalry officer insisted that the soldiers understand the mapping of the horse, where should the saddle fit, where should the cinch or the rigging should be, and what saddle goes on what type of horse in order to align the horse and rider in one plumb line. Even a Grand Prix horse, what has, let's say, 6 months off. When a horse, looking at a horse from the front, here you see the shoulder blade, upper arm, lower arm, you see the pectoralis muscle here, see my mouse going back and forth in the serratus. Here's the rib cage. Look how the elbows are in one line, but the sternum is here. The second you stop riding, remember what I said earlier? The horse's muscle, also in humans, disappear four times faster than they appear. So when you stop riding, this horse goes back to the natural position. Look where the sternum is now. Shoulders, sternum, elbow, sternum, elbow, okay? So let's say this horse is mature. The gross capsule is close at the withers. And you start riding at six, because now all the gross capsules are closed, right? There should be no more changes. The second you carry weight on the horse's back, these muscles, the serratus and the pectoralis, gets bigger. I don't care if you 15, 25, 35, 45, 65, whatever age you are, the second you lift weight and you lift and punch iron, same what horses do, they're lifting weight, pack donkeys, pack horses, pleasure horses, Olympic horses. The second you put artificial weight on the horse's back, the back gets bigger. So look at this section here. This is the trapezius, the longissimus. They change, if the horse is properly ridden, to this shape, completely different shape in the gullet plate. That's why I always recommend you, always make sure, and this is why we at Schlaeser only sell saddles what can be adjusted in the angle separately from the tree width, okay? There's two different adjustments, tree width and angle. Here you see over the shoulder, okay? When the serratus and the pectoralis gets wider, the shoulder gets wider. So to summarize up this information, one should be the saddle fitted to the horse the second you sit on the horse. How often do I, this question wasn't asked, but that's most of the time the next question. How often do you need to fit the saddle? You need to check it. You need to check it every 8 to 10 weeks. You can do it yourself. We got a wonderful long distance fitting kit. We can help you with this. Okay, there's the link. And you can check it. You can see it all yourself. How often should the flocking be done? Once or twice a year, but the horse changes all the time. So I really, really hope, I can't believe the hour is over again, but I really, really hope that you don't make the mistake and let your horse being crippled or damaged by ill-fitting saddles. Listen to your heart, listen to your gut, and hopefully you follow science and follow the law of nature. And I'm here to help, to share with you what I learned from experts from around all over the world.
Thank you so much, Jochen. And on behalf of everybody watching today, whether it be on Facebook or YouTube, thank you again for joining us again and answering all of our questions.
Okay, so I'm excited to be here next week. We're pretty much at the top of the hour again, Mary Claire. Is there anything else you might want to say?
Hello, sorry, I cut out again. But thank you again for spending the hour with us. We really, really appreciate it. And thank you everybody for sending us your questions and for sharing the stream. Join us next week for another live stream Q&A, #AskJochen.
I say goodbye with this video and I look forward to see you next week.